His image dominates Mongolia's vast open landscape today as surely as it did during his lifetime. Genghis Khan founded the world's largest continuous land empire, and today his legacy still burns brightly in modern Mongolians. I come here every few months to pay respect to our great emperor, this man says. He conquered the world. I don't say my son should grow up to be as powerful as Genghis Khan, but he must have his spirit as a descendant of Genghis. Genghis inspires devotion in some, worship in others. These people say they can channel his spirit, make his image appear. They even say his energy can enter me. Devanyam and his followers raise some eyebrows, despite his claim of direct descent from Genghis, a modern-day grandson.
They call me all kinds of names, attacking me, even though I'm a prince descended from Genghis Khan.
His claim may not be that fanciful. Some geneticists say almost 1 in 10 men in Asia, 0.5% of men across the world, carry his DNA. Not surprising, considering Genghis and his descendants conquered much of the Eurasian continent. But in recent centuries, Mongolia itself has been ruled by China and the former Soviet Union. Mention of Genghis was banned. Not anymore. His name now is synonymous with the economic rise of a new Mongolia, but in the rush for riches, there are those left behind. To them, Genghis is more myth than reality.
Life for so many people in Mongolia remains harsh and poor. Tens of thousands have flocked here to the outskirts of Ulaanbaatar looking for a share of that economic boon, only to find it's a long way off yet.
It is so difficult to be optimistic. It's already over for me. I'm thinking about my children and grandchildren. It is difficult, and I think it will get worse in the future.
Baigulma is 54 years old. She has lived in Ulaanbaatar for decades, leaving her traditional home in the countryside when her husband was in the army. Now she has grandchildren to care for, one son who can barely get out of bed with a heart condition, and another just married and erecting a ghur or tent to live in. There are 12 people in all here surviving on her husband's pension of about $80 a month and a small government handout of less than $20. Baigulma hears a lot of talk about the so-called mining boom, but doubts she or her family will ever see any of it.
I don't know. Mostly foreigners take away all the benefits. I don't know if people like us will get anything or not. Until I get it in my hands, I won't know if I will get it or not until I am actually holding it in my hands.
Like any other Mongolian, she's been raised on the stories of her country's glorious past. But where she sits now, the spirit of Genghis Khan is hard to find.
It is all just talk. Of course we respect and worship him in the home, but I cannot see any evidence of him.
To many Mongolians, Genghis Khan's spirit lives in the wolf, the emperor's animal totem. Now the wolf economy, as it is called, is moving, and the poor hope the blessings of Genghis fall to them. Stan Grant, CNN, Ulaanbaatar.